media have long disingenuously tried to soothe people by saying that Alzheimer's is not a part of normal aging and only 10% of people over 65 suffer from this disease. That's true. But what all of these statistics admit is that the chance of dementia, of which Alzheimer's is the leading cause, doubles every 5 years over 65. And at 85, you have a 50-50 chance of suffering from dementia. The second piece of bad news on this front is that in the view of serious medical researchers who aren't only trying to raise the value of the stock in their biotech companies, an effective medical intervention to delay, much less cure Alzheimer's, is probably decades, not years away. I talked to Dr. Robert Butler, who probably many of you people in this room know. He died of leukemia at age 82 last year, practically invented the field of gerontology, was the first director of the National Institute on Aging, and the only voice of sanity on the 90 is the new 50 panel. And I asked him realistically where he thought we were in terms of Alzheimer's, and he said, nobody believes in science more than I do, and I'd love to wake up tomorrow morning and find out that there's a cure for it. But I think realistically, given the complexity of this disease and of research at the basic biomedical level, when we do find something to delay it, it's more likely to be there for our children, by our, he meant people my age, and our grandchildren than it is for people who are now in their 50s and 60s. The third piece of bad news, and this is something that boomers really don't want to hear, is that exercise, a nutritious diet, maintaining a healthy weight, doing crossword puzzles, spending a lot of money on computer programs that keep your brain young, these are all good things in themselves. They're good for us doing what we like to do and being healthy at any age. And they may make us healthier in old age as they make us healthier in middle age. But they're not any kind of a magic panacea against Alzheimer's disease. How we know this, unfortunately, is the National Institutes of Health in August released a rigorous evaluation of all of these claims about how a healthy lifestyle, you won't get Alzheimer's. And what they found, as they said, the scientific proof was negligible and completely unreliable. And the scientists themselves were the most disappointed people in the world to find that there wasn't any statistically verifiable effect from this, because they wanted to believe it too. It would be wonderful. Again, I'm not saying that these things aren't all good for you, simply that they won't protect you from your point of death if there's a genetic background that predisposes you to it. I am particularly outraged, as someone who helped care for someone with Alzheimer's, by those ads for those supposed memory-enhancing drugs, which, by the way, the NIH panel also found to be negligible in their effect. You know the ones I'm talking about, the ones in which one daughter turns to the other and thankful for this great memory pill because it helps Dad be, quote, more like himself. Well, what it doesn't show is Dad taking the pill, walking out the door, getting lost, and being found by the police 7 hours later. No, that wouldn't go along with, and this is a very expensive drug, by the way. And what it does, why I find the promotion of these essentially worthless drugs so reprehensible is that when you love someone with Alzheimer's, the thing you most want to do is to be able to do something themselves. I'll tell you what these ads never show. They never show my partner turning to me on the crosstown bus and searching haltingly in the middle stages for the words to describe his frustration. I remember it as if it were yesterday. He said, I feel that somewhere inside me is the person I really am. I mean the person I used to be before, but I can't find him. I can't talk to him. Now, what do you do when someone you love says someone like that to you? Well, you try to do everything you can to stimulate the part of the brain that's still working, from attending concerts to bringing out photo albums of things you've done. And he looks at those pictures and asks repeatedly for the names of the places where the pictures were taken and says repeatedly, I'm so stupid, I'm so stupid. So that is why the marketing of these drugs is reprehensible, because you know what you do, even if you've read enough of the scientific literature to know these drugs basically don't do anything. You give it to them because it's something to make you feel that you're doing something. And you know what? The man I love knew that he would take them very docilely. But he had no faith. And then once he said in Yiddish, after taking the pill on a beautiful summer day, he said, Gornische Helfen, which means basically sort of beyond help or nothing will help. This had been the punchline of a number of old Jewish jokes he used to tell in the days when he could still tell jokes. Now, I tell this story not because this experience, either my experience of helping to care for someone or his, of knowing that his mind was dying, is unusual, but because it is common. And that is the case not just with Alzheimer's, but with many of the experiences of old age, and particularly old age, including the fact that the enormous gap between the rich and the poor in our society weighs even more heavily on the old than the young. Sergeant Shriver died last month at home, surrounded by his family, with the best palliative care money can buy. But many of us who will be among the half with dementia will die in nursing homes after our life savings have been exhausted and Medicaid takes over. That's what happened to my grandmother, only it was her, the rest of her body, not her brain, that failed her. So what's really wrong with this unrealistic image of the sexy skydiving centenarian is that it acts as a barrier to serious discussion about what we can do, not to make 90 the new 50, but a better 90, and 80 a better 80. There's a cannonball coming at us. This generation, mine, now turning 65. And all we're hearing right now from this town and state governments is short-term talk about the need to cut entitlements, meaning Medicare and Social Security, which are the major source of income for the majority of those over 75. What we need to be talking about right now is the need for better, more humane long-term care facilities, and a lot of them in just 20 years. Even more important, we need to be talking about support for the kind of in-home services that would enable people who want to take care of the people they love at home to do it for as long as they can, and would enable the healthy old who just need some help to live independently as long as possible. And we also need to be talking about part-time jobs to draw on the skills of old people who would like to work but can't find anyone to retirement, to hire them. Talk about raising the retirement age. Nobody's talking about where the jobs are coming from if you raise the retirement age. I know a lot of people in their late 60s and 70s who want to work and can't find any kind of a job. So, and I think that only when we abandon this fantasy of beating old age and feeling like a frisky 50-year-old, or better yet, a 30-year-old for the rest of our lives, can we even begin to talk seriously about what needs to be done to really prepare for the aging America. Now, some people have said to me that for boomers to believe in the fantasy of the easy death from a heart attack at 100 is no more harmful than it is for children to believe in Santa Claus. I have one reply to this. Adults are not children. Thank you.